Thanks, guys. Hopefully this is my last video on the subject. Trying to train you on deliverance. And below, I have given you all my tools that I use in deliverance. Please check them out. I'll give you more scriptures, and in it's my testimony. And I'll go through a lot of the materials later on the video. So let's backtrack a little bit. I kind of want to explain a little bit further. The Bible is clear. We will be tested. Just go to Bible.com or blueletterbible.org and type in try for the King James Version. And that's part of the plan. We want to be stronger. And in order to get to next levels, God will test us. And praise the Lord that He does. If you have a little kid, and we know that driving a vehicle is a privilege and a great asset to us, the ability to drive a car. But if we gave the keys to a seven-year-old, that privilege would be a major, major destruction for that seven-year-old. He would either kill himself or kill other people. So same thing with God. If we get things before we are ready, like if our character is not strong as it needs to be in certain areas, and we get to places of leadership and people start looking to us and we fail, then it's like that car. We have destroyed other people and ourselves. So it's a good thing that we get tested. Okay, so a lot of us are, you know, we feel like we're being tried and tested. It may not be the devil. Okay, just like Job, right? He was upright and kept himself and kept his perfect hedge. But obviously God gave Satan permission. And just because, I mean, I do believe it. God can use demons to test us, to see how will we react. Will we fight? I mean, that's a test. If we get a demon coming at us, will we fight it? Or will we just roll over and feel sorry for ourselves? That, I mean, that in itself is a test as well. What I want to emphasize, though, is that when Satan comes at us, he needs to be on the outside of us. You know, putting thoughts in our head, you know, using other Christians. I can't tell you how many times I'm driving down the road, you know, at 2 a.m., 3 a.m., I'm the only person on the road, and I'm praising God and worshiping, and there's somebody riding my tail, and then they'll cut me off. You know, I mean, they have the whole road, but yet that guy decides to mess with me. And I kind of attribute to the fact, you know, of the Matrix. You know, in the Matrix, the agents can pop up through whoever is tied into the Matrix. And I really believe that. When I first got delivered, I took the wife to for coffee. And, you know, there's a group of larger guys, you know, and they didn't look too friendly. So normally, before my deliverance, I would get that normal feeling that a guy would have, a protectiveness and okay, you know, kind of keep my eye on him and fear. But after the deliverance, like I really could feel I was disconnected from the Matrix. Things that normally should have affected me didn't affect me anymore. So that's what I'm trying to tell you. Just like Jesus Christ said, the prince of this world comes, but he has nothing in me. So Satan will still come at us, but I think a lot of our attacks are from the inside. You know, I think depression and cancer and diseases, anxiety attacks, epilepsy, I think these things are attacks from the inside. And I'm saying that that is not our portion. That is not normal life for a Christian. That is not what Christ paid for. It's just we're not taught that we can fight these things. We're not taught that we can even have demons. And so we're not even taught to fight them, okay? So that's what I'm trying to encourage you guys. I'm not saying that life is going to be, you know, peachy and you know, we just sip Mai Tais all day long. Yeah, it's in a fight. But I want to encourage you. Like, take it as encouragement that you're being attacked. One, you know, I'm sure there's probably millions of demons out there, but it's still a finite resource. Okay, it's still a strategy behind it. So if you're being attacked, it means you're doing something. It means you're a threat to the kingdom. If you're dead, sleeping, all you did was watch TV and beat your kids, Satan won't touch you because you're doing his work as it is, and he doesn't want to rock the boat. So take it as encouragement. One, if you do things for the Lord and get persecuted, that too is eternal rewards in heaven, where rust and moth and thief do not destroy. So praise God for that as well. And then also it could be a test. So God is wondering, can he give you the keys to the car? We're praying for extra gifts, and we're praying for new measures of faith. And so God answers our prayer of saying, okay, all right, let's see if you're ready. Okay. And he'll test you. It's just not like, okay, you guys got horrible character. You know, you lie all the time and you're dishonest and, you know, you like to yell at people. So I'm just, because you asked, here it is. It doesn't work like that. You will damage other people if that happens. Another thing, a personal example, I've been getting attacked by just making these videos. For an example, a couple of nights ago, me and the wife had one of our worst fights ever. And Satan is in my ear right away saying, you know, who are you to make these videos? Who are you to teach the rest of the world on how to be a good gatekeeper? And I could have listened to that and, you know, been in depressed, and these videos have never been made. But I want to switch your paradigm, you know, a little bit. Instead of being ashamed, I took it as that Satan, well, here's the deal. It was one of those fights where, you know, she says something that hurt me and I say something that hurts her, and it was going back and forth. It was just evil for evil. It was not right. And she stuck her finger, she said something that was what I already knew was a very deep wound, okay? And so what popped out of me was something unholy, and I said something unholy. And, you know, since then, you know, we made amends, and I made sure that we were good before the sun went down, you know, before we went to bed. But I could have just sat back and said, oh man, Satan is attacking me, and Satan's attacking our marriage, and, you know, guys, please pray for me. But I have prayed, and I'm sure you've prayed the same thing. Lord, if there's anything between me and you, please reveal it, because I want to be as close to you as I possibly can. I want to hear your heartbeat. If you move, I want to move. If you breathe, I want to breathe. Have you prayed that prayer? Well, I have. And so Satan showed me what was in between me and God. Satan was used to show me where that area was that I just prayed for. Okay? So that's how I look at it. So it's a win-win-win situation, guys. It is. It truly is. So now I see where that demon is. You know, I possibly need more deliverance myself. After I was delivered, when you have demons, you know, he likes to give you the, you know, there's a root of the problem, and then what sprouts out is, you know, the stink weeds, you know. For example, you know, I've been addicted to pornography for a big part of my life. Pornography is not the issue. Intimacy is the issue. The ability to feel love and to give love, that's the issue, okay? So Satan has come in into that wound and has sprouted the stink weed of pornography. And so I'm all concerned about, okay, trying to speak, you know, guard against pornography and all that stuff. And so Satan has me wound up around the fruit of the root. And instead of, but once I got delivered, that frees me up from pornography, from lust, all that stuff. And so now I can see and work on and allow the Father to come and heal that root. Does that make sense? So during the fight, she sticks her finger in a deep wound. What pops up is a red flag to me saying, okay, that obviously is tender and that needs to be fixed. I'll repent, forgive, ask the Lord to come in and heal it. Holy Spirit, is there a lie that I believe that is causing this wound to fester? I just watched a testimony on a dear sister, and she in it confessed that, you know, she had an abortion, and subsequently after that she had, I believe, three miscarriages, and her child was also on the brink of death and dying. And that just breaks my heart. And with this ministry and with Christians not being taught that demons are a real part of their life and can affect them, it's tragedies like this that keep on getting perpetuated. And that's, God has given me a righteous anger, okay? And a lot of times Satan likes to turn that anger on myself or people that I love. But this righteous anger is for the ministry. And that really upsets me, that the devil will come in and steal, kill, and destroy. I've come across the same demon. His name is Molech, and you guys know it, based on the Bohemian Grove. Well, what is Molech? They sacrifice their kids. So when you have an abortion, 9 times out of 10, you usually pick up the demon Molech. And Molech will stay in your family, giving you female problems, causing barrenness, or causing miscarriages. His whole MO is to kill your children. I also want to encourage you also that, you know, Satan tries to lie to us and say, you know, if you ever give your life over to God and you truly try to serve him and maybe even go to full-time ministry, that he's going to send you to Africa by yourself, you know. What a lie. You know, God, if he's going to has you for the ministry, which I think he has all of us for the ministry, he will cause you to do what he's made you to do. So all your desires and interests and hobbies and stuff like that, usually what, you know, I found out have played all into me becoming a good minister. You know, my characteristics, my attitude, my personality all fits into what God has for me. And so I enjoy this ministry. So God's not going to have you go do something that is just not in your heart. Plus, Jesus Christ sent him out two by two. Okay. So it's wise. I mean, just look at Proverbs and on, you know, woe is the man that falls down and has nobody to pick him up, you know? So I have a partner in this ministry, and he encourages me, I encourage him, and it's a great tool, and it's a great buffer against the enemy trying to come in and discourage one or the other. So ask, if you don't have a ministry partner, ask God to send you one. And it's been, I thank God every day for my partner. And my wife too, you know, sometimes she sits in, especially with when I'm doing deliverance on females, you know, it's always smart to have the same sex, especially when you have to reveal, you know, your deepest, darkest secrets. You don't want to be stupid, you know, because like I said, Satan will take any advantage to come in and destroy you. But anyways, I was doing a deliverance. I told my partner and, you know, I was doing deliverance on him. And the sad thing was, you know, I'm confronting the demon in him, and the demon's revealing that the reason why he entered my partner was because he believed a lie that the demon told him really early on in life, I think in his teens. And my partner's about in his 40s now. And so I asked the demon, do you have any legal right? And the demon was pretty forthright saying, no, he rebuked that lie a long time ago. But that demon was a squatter for about 30 years, okay? So even though he confessed the sin, and just like that sweet sister who probably confessed abortion and repented, that demon still stayed in her life because it was never cast out. And it was still active. It still murdered her 3 kids after that. And granted, they're in heaven, and she'll see him one day, and praise the Lord for that. But I hate the devil. He really is a steal, kill, and destroy. And he's not playing games. And neither should we. And that's why we got to be on guard. And another gatekeeper thing to do is to take every thought captive, because the battle is in the mind. And granted, like I said, we want Satan on the outside coming at us, or we want to be tested by God, okay? And Satan will use other Christians because, you know, unfortunately, you know, Christians and other people, you know, maybe they're not good gatekeepers, so Satan's able to use them to come and attack you. Have you ever had an argument with a fellow Christian and they say the most evilest thing, that it's almost a miracle that they even knew that information to tell you, like a psychic or whatever? Like they just knew the exact words to say to hit you at your very core. That was demonic. They got spiritual wisdom and insight in what to say to you. And you just need to recognize that. You know, pray for that person, bless that person, forgive them, and move on. But count it all joy, right? If you're being persecuted for what's doing what's right, then your reward is in heaven. But just don't be persecuted. 1 Peter 5, I believe. I'll make the correction right here. Don't be persecuted for being a murderer or a thief, because you deserve to be persecuted for that. So, but that's why we got to stay holy and stay on the path.
Okay.
Sickness and disease. We all know, reading the accounts of Jesus Christ, that he went around healing all sicknesses, all diseases, and casting out all demons. So, and we're also told in Mark 16 that we're given the authority to do the same thing. Okay, so we are Christ's ambassador. And so Christ gave us the authority. So when we pray for sickness, I never ask, God, is it in your will? I never do that. Because if you read about the will scriptures, it's talking about, what should I do tomorrow? Or I'm going to go do this, you know, a year from now. You know, the Bible says you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. So pray, if it's in your will, then this will happen. But when it comes to sickness and disease, we're not asked to pray, Lord, if it's in your will, please, please heal this person. When he sent out the 70, he didn't say, before you heal them, pray and see if I'm using this as a lesson to teach them patience in their life. He just said, heal them. Like, I don't ask, you know, God, is it your will that I don't look at pornography? No. it's, you know, Lord, give me a sign that, you know, I shouldn't look at pornography. I mean, we know better. It's the same thing with sickness and disease. It's God's will for you to be healed. I mean, do you want your children to be sick? And the Bible says our Heavenly Father is a greater parent than we are. So Isaiah 53, 5, okay? But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. So four things God did on the cross. It's talking about Jesus Christ. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. So he took our sins, okay, on the cross. And we don't have to pay for him, right? If he took our sins on the cross, we don't pay for him. And if I think that I have to pay for my sins by through works, the Bible's clear on that. It's saying you're spitting on the cross because you're thinking that Christ's sacrifice wasn't good enough. You have to pay for your sins, okay? The Bible's very clear about that. So, but what about peace? The chastisement of our peace was upon him. So Christ paid for your peace. And that's why when we read the Fox Book of Martyrs and these people who are just being killed for their faith, they had peace, okay? In the most dire circumstances a person can face, they had the peace of God because Jesus Christ paid for it. So it's theirs. It's ours. And the fourth thing is with his stripes, we're healed. So when he was being whipped, he was taking our diseases and sicknesses on the cross. So if you think you have to bear your sicknesses and diseases, then you're also spitting on the cross and saying, God, your sacrifice wasn't good enough. I'm going to carry the sickness and disease. Okay? Look up the word. Go to blueletterbible.org. blueletterbible.org. Isaiah 53:5. Click on healed, and you'll see what the original meaning of healed was. And you can see it's Rapha, Jehovah Rapha. It's a physical healing. I believe it's all healing, but it's definitely a physical healing. That's the number one definition. Okay? So when Jesus Christ, and I'm going to, here are some scriptures right now about Jesus Christ, who, if he can heal everybody by just laying his hands on them and speaking a word, then why didn't he? He had to heal some people because their diseases were demonically fueled. So he had to cast out the demons in order for their healing to take place.
Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him.
Okay, so if you've tried everything, if you've been prayed for, you had the elders come over, if you've fasted, if you've cried out, God, why is this sickness on me? If you've tried everything, then can we just please try what Jesus Christ did? Can we please try, okay, Lord, Holy Spirit, what is the open door that has allowed this demon to come in and to attack my flesh? or my mind, if you have an anxiety attack, or my spirit, or not my spirit, or my soul, or my heart, or my, you know what I'm saying? Not spirit, sorry. Holy of Holies can't enter there. We know that. Please, ask the Holy Spirit. Most likely it's going to be forgiveness. Most likely it could be, you know, a sin that you know of already and you just don't want to get rid of it, okay? That's your choice. Get rid of the sin or suffer. I mean, that's God's grace. You know, pain is God's megaphone, C.S. Lewis. If you're not going to listen to the still small voice, he'll send you something else, okay? We can't talk about sicknesses and diseases without talking about generational curses, okay? All right, I'm just going to go through this list. So down below, if somebody comes up to me and says, hey, I have demons, I need deliverance, so I'm going to send them three things. I'm going to send them the questionnaire. And I send them the questionnaire, usually it is all by email. And so that does two things for me. One, it tells me, are they really serious? Because like an addict, if they haven't hit bottom, rehab is not going to work. So, I mean, I learned this in my own life. I've been suicidal for like 3 times. And the last time, you know, I was like really thinking I was doing all that I needed to do. And I was to such a point of just utter depression. You know, I prayed a simple prayer of just like, God, I give up. I give up. I've done everything that I think I need to do. And I'm laid barren. I just got back from the war zone. My brother-in-law just killed himself. The family was relying on me to give them strength. I was laid waste, guys. And just a simple prayer, Lord, I give up. I'm done. And that simple prayer actually gave me a measure of deliverance just right there. That's what just God was waiting for all along, is for you to stop trying in your flesh and to really require a Savior. So that led me into deliverance. Flew to Texas and I got my deliverance. And you can read my testimony down below. I share a little bit about it. Before my deliverance, I couldn't stand silence. Even when I would go in to, you know, worship God and pray, I basically would just be reminded that the other times I was suicidal was because God wouldn't come. I wouldn't hear from God. And so the demons would remind me, you know, God has forsaken you. God has left you. And there's no more worse feeling in the world to think that your Savior has left you. So I avoided silence everywhere in the car. You know, I always had the radio on, always had the TV on. I couldn't stand silence. After deliverance, you know, I love silence now. I can hear my Father now. Lust, you know, pornography, that was taken away. Anger, a biting tongue. I had instant fruit on a lot of these folks. So anyway, so they give me the questionnaire. I send them the questionnaire. They fill it out and it gives me one of two things. It tells me if they're serious, because a lot of times I'll send them out the questionnaire and this is the hard work, folks. This is the hard work. So, you know, a lot of times I just won't hear back from them. So, you know, this is God's ministry. He sends me who is ready. You know, I don't pick up the phone and be like, hey, you know, did you do your questionnaire? God just taught me not to do that. You know, there's, you know, people have to be ready and people have to do the hard work. The second thing is that the questionnaire, they send it back and I go through it. I can see the specific detailed attack that Satan has against you. And nothing's new under the sun, folks. Nothing's new. So it's pretty easy to decipher. It is. So the questionnaire helps me out. If you look at the questionnaire at the end, it has more of the more demonic, you know, to tell me if you're, you know, what kind of scale you're on of demonization. And again, folks, if you don't think Christians can have demons, then why are Christians committing suicide? Why are Christians cutting themselves? Why are Christians can't stand the word of God? Why can't Christians, you know, blaspheme? You know, when they try to pray, all they hear is, you know, they get sexual images of Jesus or blasphemings of Jesus. You know, it's just really vile, guys. And these are Christians. These are brothers and sisters. And trying to convince me that demons can have, you know, Christians can have demons is like trying to convince a lumberjack not to believe in trees because, you know, I've seen them. I've talked to them. Okay. And I know these guys are Christians. I was a Christian. I had 30 some demons. Okay. So I really want to go, if you can print out or stop, but the canceling permissions and removing legal rights. So this is the hard work, guys. This is two thirds of the deliverance, if not three fourths of it. Like I said, casting out the demons is the easy part. This is the hard part. So forgiveness, we already went over that. That's number one. I've added and everything in here, ask the Holy Spirit. Stop, please. Ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, is there anybody I need to forgive? Okay. And then forgive them. Bless them. Okay. For me, Lord, you forgive me of my $1 billion debt. I forgive them of their $20. Okay. That helps me kind of click other people, like imagine them ripping up an IOU. Anyways, the second one is believing lies. Believing lies is an open door, guys. So Holy Spirit, if there's any lie that I believe, please reveal it to me. You know, what is the truth? Show me the scripture that combats this lie. Another open door is witchcraft, occult. Holy Spirit, reveal to me any occult sins and witchcraft permissions. Okay, I give a little list of things that, you know, Ouija boards and you know, Santeria and black magic and yoga and horoscopes, praying the saints, necromancy, blood packs, hypnosis, all that stuff, okay? So ask God to reveal that to you. Soul ties. If you have sex with anybody other than your spouse before, you know, whatever, that is a soul tie. You have become one flesh with that person, all right? So you need to sever that. Sever it. In the name of Jesus Christ, I sever that soul tie, have their stuff go back to them, have my stuff come back to me, you know. And two, when you become one flesh, demons can transfer. It doesn't happen all the time, but it can happen. So, you know, if you slept with somebody and now you got some issues in your life that you never dealt with before, well, when you became one flesh with that person, you got transferred, okay? Okay, so generational curses and false religions. Generational curses is huge, guys. And, you know, you might be a great gatekeeper right now, but you don't realize that you actually had demons before you were even born. You know, during deliverance, we understand that it's at conception that demons were passed down to you, okay? So, to be honest with you, I believe this is where the homosexuality, you know, I was born a homosexual, God made me a homosexual lie comes from. I believe there's a sexual perversion demon that came to them before they were even born. Or they were molested at a young age, or, you know, their father was in their life, their mother was in their life, and so they're seeking that connection with their father or the mother. Or, you know, they were molested and then they forgot about it. You know, there's a lot of people that when they're abused, they compartmentalize that and their body and their mind doesn't remember it. But I think that generational curse is a big thing. Because if you get a demon since conception, all of your memories, everything that you know about you is that you were bent. Your idea of the opposite sex was perverted. So I go through the prayer. You basically, to break this curse, is you basically have to take responsibility for all the sins of your ancestors. The demons are coming to you, so you're basically paying the penalty of these sins anyways. So in front of God, Lord, you know, and I have the prayer here. And again, there's nothing magical about these prayers. It's just we try to cover our bases, and these are, you know, they work. So, but you're basically standing in the gap for your whole lineage and repenting to God. And breaking every satanic oath, satanic pact that any ancestor has made. In Deuteronomy 5:9, it talks about the iniquities of generational curses. The iniquities of the fathers will pass down to the third and fourth generation. I have another scripture too, but I'll put it up right here. It's talking about that a bastard or a child. I looked up the Hebrew word. Bastard means a child that's illegitimate or of incest. And that curse is 10 generations, guys. 10 generations. And what gives a power to a curse? A demon? So it's just not some magical, I curse you, and some magic goes out and causes some damage. It's a demon takes that word, takes that assignment, and then causes havoc. You know, same thing as a blessing. I don't think some blessing is just some magical, you know, holy dust, pixie dust. You know, it's either an angel, you know, or the Holy Spirit, you know. So generational curses, guys, it's a big one. And then also, there's some other biblical curses that you should go through and see if you've committed any sins and you need to break it. So all, this whole thing right here is basically taking away the legal right from all the demons. We're just trying to cover our bases just as much as we can before we even come into the, for the deliverance. So we're just trying to cover, we're just trying to cancel all legal rights and permissions of any demon whatsoever that you can come in contact with. And so when you sit in the chair across from me, you know, these demons have no legal rights and they're just, okay, you know, getting ready to cast out, okay? The next sheet is the checklist. And this is just for me, just a reminder for me. I made a deliverance binder, so I have some handouts, you know, that I like to give them to them. Anointing oil is big, especially, you know, if there's a demon that we come across that is doing damage to the client, you know, we tell the demon to fix their damage, and I'll go more into that later. But then after it's all done, we pray for healing, and you know, it's pretty powerful, guys. Especially if we find demons that specifically is damaging that area of your life that's causing sickness, cast it out, and then we pray for healing, and you know, it works. So anointing oil. Sometimes maybe if they're getting confused, also maybe anoint them right then. Try to consecrate their mind. Obviously a Bible, pens, a voice recorder. In case I catch something cool, to be honest with you. When I did deliverance on my partner, a Goliath came through him and he laughed at me. Oh man, that sent shivers up my spine. I really had to keep my courage because it was pretty unnerving. But man, that laugh that came from my partner was pretty unnerving. But anyway, so unfortunately I didn't record that, but a voice recorder also too is a accountability. You know, I don't want Satan to use that person later on and say, you know, hey, I molested them or attacked them or something. You know, it's just kind of protection for you and for them. It's kind of another witness, you know, as it were. The answered questionnaire, obviously, if they turn it in. Water is good to have on hand. You need a quiet, private, well-lit room. Quiet, obviously, because you don't want, obviously, distractions. You don't want kids running in and yanking on the mom. Well lit, I like to look at their eyes. A lot of times they need to close their eyes to get the answers. And I'll go into it a little bit later. But I also like well lit because you can actually see quite a bit by looking at that person's eyes. You know, the window, the eyes truly are the window to the soul. A trash can, if they vomit, you know, I don't think they need to. You know, a spirit is called breath. So yeah, they may exhale or cough or whatever. And if they vomit and the demon's coming out, you know, most likely I'll tell the demon, you know, just come out. You do not need to hit their gag reflex. But the trash can's there just in case, you know, rather be, safe than sorry. Lots of tissue. Obviously this is an emotional thing. We're hitting on the deepest, darkest parts of people, tissue, breath mints. Obviously I don't want to kill the client. And then cell phones are turned off. Okay. All right. So this is the fun part, guys. This is what I've been waiting for. This whole series of video is to teach you what's on this next sheet. And this is my deliverance worksheet. Okay? This is my deliverance worksheet. So, again, please go downstairs, pause the video, print this out, and go along with me, please.